friendly listener, you are now tuned in to the Rambling Rogue Show. I am your host, as always, you know what I'm saying, and humbly, Rambling Rogue, aka Jaiz Rogue, Jaiz in the Jungle, whatever you want to call me. You are now in and actually in line of about 20 minutes to about 30 minutes, possibly even maybe even 40 minutes of just rambles from me. Okay, you know, you can use this as, you know, voice filler, you know, if you want to, like if you want to just kind of zone out and just have something just kind of going, like that's how I'm like, man, you know what I'm saying, or woman, you know, where it's like I'm the kind of person that just needs a voice going. So you'll catch me with like a YouTube video just running, and it'll just be just running, and it'll just be just going. You know, a lot of times music, you know, it doesn't really help as like a filler thing for me. So a lot of times I just like to just have somebody's voice, and whenever I like, you know, have the brain capacity to even just lean in, I'm like, hey, what's that guy doing over there now? You know, I like live streams. You know, you can get into a live stream. You just put it up on the street on the screen, and then basically you just sit there and you just kind of tune in and out. You know, you kind of just go about your business while they're going about their business, and you can kind of just tune in. So if you're a person like that that just likes to, you know, just have something going, please feel free to use the Rambling Rogue Show for any of those kinds of services. You know what I'm saying? That's what the show's for. It's for people just like me that just sit around and they just need a voice. It's also for people that just want to, you know, listen to somebody's opinion on a few things. It's also for people that are interested in personally me. So whatever your interests are, shout out to you for listening so far. Round of applause for you as always, listener. Seriously, you guys are great. I think on the last episode we had like 20 views or some shit like that, man. Like, that's pretty damn lit, like, for the YouTube. So, shout out to you if you're listening to this on YouTube. Shout out to you if you're listening to this on SoundCloud. I'm actually going to try to push the SoundCloud viewership a little bit more, possibly. I mean, I always say stuff that I'm going to do for this podcast that I never do. But, excuse me. Well, I said excuse me, but in all realisticness, I could edit that out. Now, will I edit it out? It will be for the scholars. If I don't edit it out, tell me how much you hate me for not editing that sneeze out. Or tell me how much you love me for not editing that sneeze out in the comments of this Rambling Rogue Show, if you're listening. Anyway, we don't have much to ramble about today, listener. June 4th. It is 10:49, and I'm not gonna lie, I've said this before, and I'm just gonna explain it again. You know, I'm one of those funky moods, excuse me, that the show kind of puts on me before I start recording. I always get this like just huge feeling of cold feet and like anxiety. And it doesn't really even necessarily come from anything in particular. Like, I don't really ever, you know, have any kind of fear or any specific thing. It's like, I'm just, you know, I'm just coming here to talk. But it's like, you know, it just still builds up in me this kind of wall to not do the show, to kind of just go to sleep, let the next day come, and then just kind of see what happens. And, you know, I've even been doing that for the past few weeks, listener. And believe it or not, I've even been, you know, basically just on Instagram, just explaining, okay, oh, the episode's coming out now on Monday because, you know, et cetera reason. When really, honestly, what it boils down to is just, you know, I mean, I just don't feel comfortable a lot of these times. And it's just, it's very difficult for me to work this up. I mean, first world problems, right? Like, shit, Jesus. It's hard for me to actually get up and do my fucking podcast because it gives me anxiety. Ooh, boo-hoo. I'm not trying to... Don't think I'm fishing for a sympathy card. We just talking here, listener. But, you know, it's just one of those things, man. It's just one of those things I go through where, for no reason at all, I should not feel anything before hitting record. I should just get up, set the camera up, set up the stuff over here, like my mic and everything, clap, and then we're done. And, you know, we're getting it. We're making content. But that's just not what it's like, you know? You know, I'd really love it where, like, I would be a little bit more proactive, and I would love it if I was, like, a little bit more of that guy who kind of just kept up with, like, events so much that maybe even the Rambling Rogue Show had a couple episodes, you know, every week. But, you know, honestly, I've just come to realize that that's just not me. And without a team, without other people around me, that's just not something that I even have any desire to facilitate, you know? It's just a personal thing. The Rambling Rogue Show has just evolved into this kind of confessional where I just come in and I just kind of dish everything out at you. And, you know, while that may not have been exactly what I wanted it to be, like I said, you know, I would really love a show that was more like akin to, like, I mean, they're still doing this show, believe it or not, Everyday Struggle, you know, with DJ Academics and them over a Complex. And, you know, like, I would love to do a show where, like, I could just have a hot take, an opinion on these, like, you know, just bubbling things that are happening of now. And of course I can do that. I mean, I'm saying a lot of can't without having anything actually in front of me to stop me. I understand that, listener. But what I'm saying is it just doesn't roll off of me. It doesn't catch my attention. What does catch my attention is the song that you guys heard at the beginning of this. Sorry that I'm just cutting into this now, but that's the Rambling Rogue Show. You know, you know how we do over here. It's okay. When your soundboard does not work the first time. I hit the wrong button every single time.
It's Ramble Time.
Okay, basically, that's how we run in the Rambling Rogue Show. But yeah, what is capturing my interest right about now, if you must know, listener, it's music. And, you know, in the beginning of this, if you were paying close attention, that's some prime new Gyres Rogue music, the first minute of this. We did a different intro from the League intro that we normally do. And, you know, that's some music that's actually unreleased. And it's actually going to be coming out on, you know, just, you know, a further project, the Linda EP, something I've talked about many different times. And basically, yeah, that's pretty much the closer track there. And, man, I'm just fucking loving this song. I'm loving this fucking song. It's just, it gives me so much feeling. And I wrote it so quickly, and it's usually the songs that I just write so quickly that, like, I just literally just got off, and it was just, like, within a feeling that I had that I wrote it. It's just those songs that just hit me so much. And, yeah, man, it's a melancholy, very sad, very down song, but, hey, it's a good way to end the mixtape, in my opinion. And I think that when it comes out, when you guys will be able to hear the full thing, I think that you guys will pretty much, I think you guys will enjoy it, man. I think if you enjoy some music that isn't always, you know, so uplifting, isn't always so, you know, I guess, smooth. If you're into some music that's a little bit underground, I think you're going to be interested to hear what's going on the Linda EP, and specifically that song. So, and right now I don't even have a name for the song. It's supposed to just close out the thing, so I just have it titled Linda Last Song, but that'll change. It's the Rambling Rogue Show. We're on, like, episode 22. Still a virgin. Just want to say that, like, randomly. Because, you know, that just has to cut the room. That just has to cut everything. You know, just want to throw that bit of information out there. Oh yeah, here we go. It's official. I'm now, like, seeing things in the corner of my eye. So I am losing it. I am I'm losing it. Because, bruh, literally I'll be, like, washing dishes and I'll just see, like a gray figure, like a smoke. Like a ball of smoke. That just has so much movement. I'll just see that type of shit. or not even smoke, but it's just like something that like just has like a lot of movement, a lot of like something that's just very dynamic. I'll see that just floating on the sink, or not floating on the sink. I'll see that floating on the countertop next to the sink, right? While I'm washing dishes. I'll see like today, right? My car actually didn't break down, but you know, my car is pretty old. My car, Linda. Toyota Camry 2001. She's kind of old. And so, Jesus, I want to write down an idea right now. She's kind of old, and so I need to constantly take her in for maintenance and things like that. So today even, right? I took her to the shop, and I took it upon myself because the shop's not too far, you know, to just walk back and forth from the shop to my house. It's about maybe like 25-minute walk, something like that, you know, straight up or whatever. Basically, you know, while I'm walking, I'm just seeing weird-ass figures because I'm reading as well. You know, I've got this big old book. It's called like The Big Payback or The Big Paycheck or whatever. It's actually super interesting. It's about how like hip hop executives basically, you know, hip hop executives with the help of artists helped form the, I guess, structure, you could say, for like people to make money in hip hop. It's really great. But I'm only like eight pages in. It's really good. But I'm reading my book, and yeah, dude, like in the corner of my eye, I'm literally seeing things that look like squirrels, animals moving around. I'm seeing things that just look like just straight figures. Sometimes it'll just be things that just give me this like just weird presence, like not like a person, but like maybe like a just an ominous figure, you know, because it'll just be something that like I'll kind of see it and I won't even recognize it. So then it'll just be like, dude, what the hell was that? And so yeah, I'm losing it. And yeah, that's pretty much where we're at, like, you know, with our mental state. Our emotional state is pretty decent. You know, we're pretty happy on a day-to-day basis. We're not going through, I guess, you know, like, too much nonsense right now. I mean, our crush from the Crush Chronicles sadly did block us. And like I said last week, that's pretty... I'm pretty sure that's because, you know, her coworker, one of my friends, ended up, you know, just telling her that, relaying this message that I had said, where I was saying basically, and this is facts, I got some advice to do this. I can't pop up inside of her like place of employment anymore, just because of the fact that it's just like, dog, like you're not anything to this person other than just a dude that just is like trying to get at her. And even if you kind of like justify it with that guise of, oh, you're trying to go get a movie and, you know what I'm saying, do all of that, you're still trying to, at the end of the day, get this chick, and you're still spending money to do so and not getting anything. So it's like, and you know, not to be too misogynistic, not to be too much of a pig, but I'm just saying this. If I spend my time on something like that and then I'm also spending my money, something has to give when... You know, I mean, just time and again, even though the connection is there, even though, you know, just everything that you would think should be present in a relationship, even though you would think that that's present, even though you think that that's there, it's just not. And you know, something has to give. And, you know, let me rephrase that. Not that it's not there, but it's just that one of the parties just does not want to acknowledge it. Now, that sounds very like, you know, weird dude, obsessive type. Like, and I think to an extent I am that, but I'll never sweat a chick. Like, I'll never be like, this is how I feel. You have to feel like that. This is how I feel. And that's just my crazy mind. I express that to you. And if you don't feel the same way, it's possible I expressed that too early. But if you don't feel the same way, you just don't feel the same way, period. And we have to treat things like, you know, like a forward stream. I mean, we have to keep moving. You have to keep going down. But, you know, I wish that person nothing but the, I'm not even going to say that. I just wish that person honestly would have saw something in me like I saw something in them. I honestly think they did see that in me, my crush. But I think the problem is this weird age thing. Like I mentioned a few episodes back, she is a, you know, maybe what, 2 years older than me? And these girls at like, you know, and she's also, you know, towards the end of her college career. These girls at the end of the college career, these girls that are now more established, they're getting into their 20s. They're looking just for experiences that are more solid, not more experimental, not very, you know what I'm saying? I mean, like, yes, they are experimental themselves, maybe, per se. But I don't think that they're looking for a person that's still trying to kind of find their footing. I don't think they look towards a person attractively at a person that's like, you know, still just, you know, just kind of just forming it out, making the shape. I think these people are more into just full on characters. You know what I'm saying? Like just dudes that have basically been through a few years inside of a scene or two. And so that they could just totally envelop you in it. Case in point. You know, like I was at that metal show and I was just seeing chicks, a few chicks, you know, just gleam over these dudes who, you know, they're at this show and they don't look like me and my homie where we're just kind of like cool and just doing our thing, just kind of outliers. They're more accustomed to the show. They're more accustomed to, you know, basically the attire there, the mood, the vibe, etc. You know, they drink a lot more, they smoke cigarettes, whatever the case. Girls like that are into shit like that, this chick. And you know, that's just a shame. But it is what it is. It is what it is. And when I say it is what it is, that doesn't, like, I don't want that to negate how I feel. I still feel tragic about this, you know, and I've been giving it a lot of thought as to, like, would it be right now that I've already kind of exposed my feelings for this person to kind of just approach this person and say, hey, you know what, maybe it doesn't work for us that way. But, and this is true, this is very true. Please listen to this, listener. This is my heart of hearts. I would love to just express to this person that, yo, I just mess around. Like, I like just being in your presence so much so that I would even have you on this podcast. I've told this person, like, just like low-key on some co-host type shit where we literally just shoot the shit on nothing. And we don't even have to, we don't have to do anything in any other way. You know what I'm saying? Like, I would love that. But it's like, yeah, like I literally just like shooting the shit with you. And so it's just one of those kinds of situations. I don't know if that would be right for me to go in and say, hey, can we make some kind of super friendship? Not that it wouldn't be right, because it's my opinion. Maybe more so that it wouldn't be. Would that be okay? Like, for me at least. Like, should I strive out and do that, or should I just let the relationship just kind of just go where this other person has led it? You know, I ask myself these things. It's like, who decides, or not really that, or it's like, kind of, when do we decide to go hard for a person? You know, it's like, yeah, family, okay. But then besides that, it's like, even for these kind of new friends that you make, or, you know, college acquaintances, things like that, when do you decide to go hard? And, you know, I don't know. Maybe my personal, I guess, switch for going hard on somebody or for going hard into somebody, I guess that's a little bit, it's like a lower threshold for me in that, like, oh, you give me you give me an inch, I'll take you a mile. But I think a lot of other people, it's really just the opposite. And, you know, you really got to fight and you got to build something with them. And for me, it's like, I don't know if it's always been like this, but it's just this feeling when I mess with chicks, especially chicks like that, you know, we're just, like, I understand that you want me to, I guess, build something more with you, but you're not even giving me anything to work with. And then it's like, I don't know. I don't want to get into that. But, I mean, I don't want to get further into that than I already have. I'm pretty sure I've already rambled quite a bit about that. But, yeah, that's where we're at with the crush. You know, she's blocked my number. Why? You know, again, it's because word of mouth. I know I didn't say anything that was that crazy. I mean, I've said so many different things inside of the small chat that she and her had, because again, she never responded. Yet I know she was reading everything because she would not never respond, but she would respond here and there. And whenever we even would talk, she would even reference some of the things I would say inside of the text. But, you know, it's like, you know, you get blocked. And then I've made this wall against myself to not go into the store anymore. So it's just, I'm thinking about just letting it just be there. Of course, you know, we're not letting that be the only look that we're looking at, of course, right? But, you know, I like this person. I do. You know, and again, I ask that question of when do you go hard? When do you decide to go hard? I like this person just because, hey, I've already had a 3-hour conversation with you, a literal 3-hour damn near conversation with you. And it didn't seem like much time had passed at all. It seemed like it was like old friends just chatting it up. And we weren't even high or drunk. I might have been high. Actually, not fuck might have. I probably was stoned. But even that fact, I mean, if you can get me while I'm stoned to actually just start expounding to you, you know what I'm saying? Like I want to. Look at how long it takes for me to just start up this podcast. So much anxiety for me to start up this podcast. It takes me about, I don't know, I've been probably sitting in this chair waiting to start this for about 30 minutes, 40 minutes. And actually, that's a lie. For a couple hours now, because I even was outside chiefing it, you know, to kind of quell my anxieties. Smoking some weed or whatever. And yeah, that was about, yeah, maybe like an hour ago. So it's like, you're looking at it going, I walk in and that's an automatic thing where we just start shooting the shit. And I felt what it's like when, and this isn't even like a sex thing, just chemistry in general. If you're a fan of me, you know what I'm gonna reference now. It's the Banana Boys. You know what I'm saying? The Banana Boys podcast literally was just, it was just chemistry. You know, it was just, it's literally what you got when you took two very passionate people that wanted to talk for hours, that could talk for hours, because trust me, that's the only thing we would do. And it's what you get when you put those two people together and you make a product of that. I think when you get that again, it's kind of unmistakable. And I think it's one of those things where it's like, I've tasted this before. I know exactly what this is. And that's what it is. That's how I feel with this person. So, yeah, you know, that's where I'm at with my crush. I'm going to share some ideas. Oh, by the way, before I go into ideas, I'm considering celibacy. I really, really super duper am. Celibacy in the fullest state. No jerking off. No, you know, just negating all of those thoughts. No pursuing girls. No pursuing anybody. Just pursuing my passions. Going after the goals that I have set out in front of myself. Outside of that, even with my family. Just different things. I'm considering it heavily. I mean, it's like, sheesh. 19 years old and you're still a virgin. You might as well just set it so that you could, like, have, like, a record. You know what I'm saying? Like, shit, I lost my shit at, like, 21. You know what I'm saying? Like, I could have lost it many days. Like, that's the thing. I think the cool thing about me, and I don't know if this is for, like, all 19-year-old virgins, so please take this with a grain of salt, but I think the cool thing about me is that I'm, like, confident and, like, secure enough in myself and the way I am, the way I look, things like that, that, like, that fact doesn't bother me so much. And I'm also, it's also cool that, like, you know, I've actually had some experiences with women, so it's like, you know, at least there's that to kind of hold you over. And honestly, yeah, rambling, sorry, considering celibacy. Anyway, I want to share some ideas. I want to put this out onto the podcast because I would love it for like a video version of this to exist. A video version. I would love it for a recorded, you know, just version of this to exist. Where I'm actually just, you know, speaking about this idea at length, you know, just to you. I really, really want to start my own, I guess you could say, music venue. And my idea right now, at the present, is to, because I have a picnic table outside my house that is just basically unused. And, you know, it just gives you enough platform for a stage. It really does. And I'm thinking about modifying it and placing it in a different place around my house so that I could not only have a stage set up, but so that I would also have a trusty and reliable, you know what I'm saying, access way to like different parts of my house where other things would be available. You know, and let's say if I put on like a venue type of thing, right? And by other things, I mean food. You know, my vision right now, and it's a bustling one. It's one where it's like, I think you could even tell. It's hard for me to even get it into words because there's just so many thoughts right now. They're all conflicting. They're all clashing. They're all going at each other. And they're all essentially, you know, like, they're just all bubbling because it's like there's just different idea on top of new idea, and I want to get it all down. And even now, I'm so eager to just get off this podcast and just think about this. But my idea right now is to just have this amazing spot where, hey, we got a stage, we would have speakers set up, we would have a mic set up, and then we would have it so that artists that, you know, primarily use their voice, right, and other artists too if they'd like, but artists that primarily use the voice or other mediums that you know they only need a microphone for could showcase their talents. I think something like this would be awesome. I think something like this would just switch up how people see this entire area that I live in. I think it would be groundbreaking for the area that I live in, and I think that, while not totally original, while not any of, you know, unique, whatever, I think that this idea could foster so much creativity, and it could foster in just this new kind of, I guess, attitude about the IE, the Inland Empire, and its artists. More things like this could inspire kids in the next city over to do something like this. And the next thing you know, you've got 5 different cities where IE artists are just bubbling. And it's a damn near a Beast Coast movement where instead of kids from different boroughs, or I mean just the Beast Coast movement, really any movement, but where kids from different boroughs and different places inside of this one big city are all now just kind of making a name and a way for themselves. You know, I see this thing where it's me, my stage, my boys, and we're putting on a good show for people while we're also serving food and we're also trying to just spread the message of supporting the local artist. You know, and again, I want to do it with a picnic table. I'm super inspired by the guys at Deuce Palooza. You know what I'm saying? If you're not familiar with that, if you don't watch the Joe Budden's podcast, Joe Budden, you know, one of his boys that actually hosts the podcast with him, Rory, who was a, like, to my understanding was like a, you know, record exec or some kind of executive or just, you know, or an A&R type, you know, before, but now he's kind of just, you know, in the industry. I don't know what he does, but he puts on a now monthly show. And I guess you could call it a show, but you really would call it, I don't even know. You just call it a lit ass get together. They put this thing on, Rory and his team, and they call it Deuce Palooza. Now, what Deuce Palooza actually started as was this event, right? That's a good word for it. This event called Henny Palooza. Now, Henny Palooza was started by these, I think it was like 6 friends inside of one of the friends' attics. And if you've ever seen The Get Down on Netflix, great ass show that they took down, even though I don't even watch Netflix anymore. I'm totally unplugged from that. But great ass show that they took down, by the way. Didn't even get to see a season 3. I was so shocked by that, I didn't even watch season 2. I was like, wow, y'all really did that. But that first season was great to me. And they show you these kind of attic parties where you literally, or not even attic, but basement parties, where you literally just have kids inside of a basement, one DJ, they're mixing, tight ass spot, tight little space, everybody, they're just moving, jumping, crowd is going crazy. I don't know why I brought that up. Why did I bring that up? The Get Down. Well, I know that's something that I want to facilitate, but damn, I brought that up for a reason. Wow, all this rambling. We've been rambling for about 31 minutes, and that's the first time I've actually lost myself where I didn't know what I was referring to. I brought that up for a reason. But that kind of environment that the Get Down and you know, like, kind of just embodies, that's what I would really love to have at my shows, where people come in and we facilitate just this vibe, man. This kind of feeling that, hey, it's okay to just have fun right now for just a little bit, and to have fun not just, you know, with, like, established music, not just with, you know, just shit that you're supposed to have fun with, like, you know, like a prom or like a school dance or whatever, you know, like just something out of the box where we're actually having fun with people that look like us, with people that we probably know, with people that just, you know what I'm saying? My area right now for young people is just not existent. Everybody goes to either Riverside County, or they go to the OC, or they go, of course, to LA for everything. And I'm like, yo, you do know that we're just commuting out to go get things that we could facilitate for ourselves. So, and I've always been a big person of, you know, like, I'm the kind of kid who, he's at the playground and he's having a great fucking time, yet he realizes, hey, the good time was just in the slide. It was just in the toys. It was just in the, I guess, the things that were there. You know what I'm saying? And when the kid finally gets that kit from his parents, what does the kid do? Does he go to the park? You know, does he go enjoy the park, which was still cool? No, he sits there and he has a great time at his house, but he doesn't keep it to himself. See, I'm the kid who gets the kit for like a cool little play set in my backyard, and then I invite everybody over, and then we just, and then we have a lit time. And that's a really crazy long-armed freaking analogy, but there you go. I want to build a stage at my house so that I can perform, and so that I could actually have a place where people would feel comfortable to kind of let loose, young people especially. I think Kanye is fighting for people like me. So here's an idea. I think that with what he's doing, first of all, I love his album. Okay? I love the album. Like, I just love it sonically and I love it topically. Like, the music there, for the most part, it just gets my head either banging or it gets me damn near to tears. Or in the case of when I was listening to Ghost Vision, I believe that song's called, like, 2 days ago, literally had me bawling in here. Like, I, you know, like, those lyrics about, you know, just trying to love somebody and everything you do just pulls them away. I mean, damn it. You could have just slapped Crush Chronicles right there. And you got that. That's literally such a simplified version of exactly that experience. But, or at least with that crush. But, you know, I love the album, and I think that Kanye is fighting for people like me. He's fighting for people that get excited for us, that, you know, we get all these ideas for us, that envision ourselves in different places, not necessarily higher places all the time, but just for us that have all these visions, for us that, you know, just think these things. I think that he made this album, I guess, in an image of himself, but I think that that's where he's at, where he's in this, I guess, place of just creation of, again, I don't want to say free thought, because I think that's a little bit of a meme, but of just real time thinking, of just, you know, I gotta say, man, the feeling that it just gives to me when we're not even looking at, like, just the way the music sounds, it's so out of here. It's so out of here. But the music itself, too, then, of course, you know, the beats, like I said, they're just so banging, you know, or they're just so, just heart-wrenching, or they're just so weird. Like that first song, like seriously, like the like that. I don't even know what the hell's going on there with that. I don't, but I love it. And I think he's fighting, I don't want to say the good fight, I think Kanye's fighting the necessary fight. And I think he's doing it in his own way, and I don't think that there was a necessary way specifically to fight this fight. I think that this is a fight that gets fought between an artist and the public masses. And I think that after this fight, it is now much easier for people like me to now break in and have my weird ideas, but to not just break in and be underground, but to break in and actually reach some level of, let's not say mainstream, let's say influence. And so, yes, I appreciate Kanye for that, and I see that effect in his music. You may not see that, and if you don't see that, I would really love it if you like voice that opinion. If you're a person that, shit, you might even be a person that just straight up canceled Kanye. Please let me know. Let me know why you did that, and let me know also how, at least in your eyes, how that, I guess, pushes anything forward. And not to be salty, but really though, like, yeah, you don't listen to the music that you know, and all of that dies. But if there was truly something to gain from the music, like just objectively, you know, from the person, which, you know, let me let it be known, I do disagree with a lot of what Kanye was spilling out, you know, these past like couple months, but or past month. But yeah, just let me know why you guys canceled Kanye, and just let me know, yeah, just your feelings, if you'd like and care to. Silly Songs Volume 2. So we're just doing no transitions at this point. We're literally just going from thing to thing. Silly Songs Volume 2 will come to you soon. We will have more silly songs for you. Definitely going to be a bigger track list. Probably more than three songs. Not even probably. Will be more than three songs for sure. Silly Songs Volume 2. Check it out. It's going to be pretty cool. It's going to be music that hopefully I'm going to be able to perform, because that's kind of the idea with these silly songs. They're just supposed to be songs that are silly, have, you know, oftentimes a lot of energy, and are just, you know, just easy to perform. They're silly songs, and they're songs that just get you, they just get you going, whatever. So yeah, we will be doing Silly Songs Volume 2 before we do Linda EP. You know what I'm saying? For the Linda EP, we have some big aspirations for that. We have some big ideas for that. And honestly, right now at this point, I'm not going to even front. I'm not going to flex nothing. I just don't even feel comfortable with putting out the Linda EP. I feel like if I put it out right now, it's just, it doesn't even make sense to. They say don't, like my mentor, my spirit mentor, Virgil Abloh, says not to be perfectionist. To not take an art piece so seriously, to not put, you know, just to do these things, but and to kind of just let it. But I believe that I'm just letting my album, and by that I mean my project. By that I mean I'm just letting it have its appropriate time, because, or I'm letting it gain its appropriate, I guess you could say, weight. Or I guess you could say I'm letting it gain its like the way, the same way that fine wine ages and gets better, I'm letting it do that. I'm letting it, there's a word for that, but I'm letting it do that. And essentially what I mean there with that is every time I revisit this tape, I always make something better on it. And not only am I making something better on it, but it's like, it's just a new idea, and it's just a nuance to probably something that's like already been there. Sometimes it'll even be in lyrics where I like literally I'll just change something like that I was saying completely, you know, before in a completely done and recorded version of a song, and I'll just change it just because, hey, it didn't feel right when I said it like that, or just whatever. So then you have that, right? And then on top of like just those feelings, I just feel like the Linda EP deserves visuals, dedicated visuals. And it's something I did not foresee was going to be so damn difficult when I set out to actually do this. But yeah, no, making visuals is difficult. It's very, very hard. And you know, I've got a camera, I've got some equipment, I've got a DAW. You know, I could definitely edit and do it myself and this, that, and the third, but I'm not gonna lie, you know, it takes a lot of know-how, and to make it come off decent, it takes, you know, a little bit of finesse. And so while I'm not saying I'm waiting for a director to come and to help me with this, because I am actively sourcing, searching, trying to find that eager person that, you know, is just more about the passion of things and is less about, you know, the monetization of things. I won't say waiting, but I'm letting that person come to me so that we can make something amazing for the Linda EP. Because I feel like the things I say there too, while they're just talking to an inanimate object, I feel like, you know, with like a good visual on a couple of the tracks, you know, I could really push some of these themes and ideas home and maybe, you know, make people think about things they just weren't thinking about and have them engaged, kind of, you know. That's what I want, engagement. But Linda EP, Silly Songs Volume 2, it'll be just a set of songs that, you know, like I said, I could perform those. So if my idea of making a stage and performing goes through, Silly Songs Volumes 1, 2, let's hope 3 and even more would be the songs that would probably be played, you know, like if that happened in the near future, you know what I'm saying, like the very near future. But which it probably won't, but I say but a lot. I've rambled on for about 43 minutes. Tim the Shaman wants to get onto the podcast. I'm going to have Tim the Shaman on the podcast. Tim the Shaman is actually a shaman of mine that lives up the street. And, you know, he's actually the guy who got me into square foot gardening, which is the way that you would garden if, you know, you want to actually, you know, reap the most, like, I guess, out of your crops. And I guess, you know, not only that, but just, if you want to basically just have so much control over what you grow, you know, and if you want to be able to grow a lot, it's just basically the foundation of that. So he's teaching me that stuff. He wants to get onto the podcast. That's going to happen. And what else? 1999, babies be coming up. Anything else? No? All right. Thanks for listening.